President Trump's personal account was permanently suspended by Twitter with the reason of the risk of further incitement of violence. It sparked criticism from world leaders, including the President of France and even the Chancellor of Germany. Today, let's stretch our whip on the dodgy, bad-behaving big techs, Twitter, the evil bird, specifically. Welcome to Beyond the News with Faye and Faye. Actually, Twitter doesn't seem to just working on getting rid of Trump and Trump supporters' Twitter accounts. It has a deeper history of censoring, or should I say, educational censoring of Twitter users. Let's first take a quick look at a few examples. In October 2017, Twitter was accused by actress Rose McGowan of suspending her account for 12 hours, which came after she tweeted about the former film studio executive, the notorious Harvey Weinstein's alleged sexual misconduct towards her and others. We know that this guy Weinstein, who was accused by 106 women publicly, was in fact guilty of being a sexual predator. But why did Twitter censor this information? I'm wondering, is there any relationship between the Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey and Weinstein? In February 2017, Victoria Fierce's account was temporarily suspended with the reason of swearing at the US Vice President Mike Pence. Interesting. So it is a behavioral re-educational action that Twitter took against Victoria Fierce, as what she did was outside of the Twitter thing. And Mr. Roger Stone, American conservative and political lobbyist, his Twitter was permanently suspended in October 2017 due to his opinion against CNN. And maybe also because of the fact that he worked at four of the Republican president's campaigns. There is more, the Al Jazeera Arabic's Twitter account was temporarily suspended in June 2017 for unknown reasons. Do you start feeling the chill at your back now? I can provide a very long list for you on Twitter's suspended accounts, but let's move to the other side of the coin, those accounts Twitter is happily keeping alive. Ali Khamenei, the Islamic Republic's so-called supreme leader of Iran, his Twitter account is alive and thriving. For those of you who are living in Australia, I'm sure you are thinking one of the accounts that I'm thinking, the China's foreign ministry spokesperson Zhao Lijian, who tweeted a fake photoshopped image of a grinning Australian soldier appearing to slit the throat of an Afghan child with a caption of, "Don't be afraid, we are coming to bring you peace." This image was labeled as repugnant by Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison, and the problem is, when Scott Morrison pleaded for Twitter to take the image down, Twitter refused to do so. From its website, Twitter says people are allowed to post content, including potentially inflammatory content, and Twitter does not screen or remove potentially offensive content. Interesting, huh? For a fake and inflammatory image, Twitter thinks it's wrong to remove it. So, in another way to look at the current situation at the Twitter suspension fanatic, allow me to ask, was Trump a much more dangerous Twitter user than those always up to no good users from the dictatorial countries? Or are we living in the deep of a dictatorial place where we once called the democratic world? What's your take on this? Please let me know. 2 days ago, an independent investigation group Project Veritas leaked a video showing how the Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey was talking about Trump and how they are to lay out a roadmap for censorship doings. Dorsey said, "We are focused on one account right now, but this is going to be much bigger than just one account.
It's going to go on for much longer than just this day, this week, the next few weeks. It's going to go on beyond the inauguration. We have to expect that. We have to be ready for that. So the focus is certainly on this account and how it ties to real-world violence, but also we need to think much longer term around how these dynamics play out over time. I don't believe this is going away anytime soon."
Yeah, you hear that. They are thinking much longer terms on how to play out of the dynamics of censoring. Now, Twitter is able to censor the president of USA. Who else can they censor? What else they can't censor? Let's look and think further on the reasons given by Twitter on suspending Trump's account. One reason provided was to prevent him from sending misinformation to the mainstream. Also, another reason was that Twitter boss Dorsey had drawn a line in the sand that the president of USA could not cross. Okay, right. Both the disinformation from the president and the line in the sand are topics that we have much to talk about. But let's just first talk about the less trivial part, the disinformation bit. Let's see if it can stand scrutiny. For example, now that the disinformation is all over the world, everything sent out from the Chinese CCP leaders and its mouthpiece media, anything sent out from the dictators of Iran or North Korea are all real and solid disinformation. Why doesn't Jack Dorsey stop them? Let's look at a more local disinformation center, the California Congressman Adam Schiff. As for the number two person on the House Intelligence Committee at the time, he made blatant lies on TV that he saw a lot of evidence in the confidential briefings he obtained as a member of the Intelligence Committee, which proved that Trump really communicated with Russia. But now, when we look back, especially after the intelligence docs from Obamagate were declassified today, we all know that the Russiagate drama was just a lie and a witch hunt that the Democrats were using to attack Trump. Then how come Twitter never censored Schiff's remarks? This suspension of the president's Twitter account sets a bad precedent. If Trump's account can be censored for today for a reason Jack seems fit, who else can be the target for Dorsey to teach a lesson tomorrow? What about other conservative opinionated leaders? What if one day Jack Dorsey decided to become a right-wing conservative? And would he be censoring most of these extreme lefties we're seeing today? Biden? Harris? I have to say, nothing happens without consequences. The Chinese way of saying it is that you reap what you sow. A report revealed that, so far over the last two trading periods, Facebook and Twitter have collectively wiped out $51.2 billion in combined market value since the banning of the President of the United States. Yesterday, Dorsey asked on Twitter whether what he did to Trump was correct. Surprisingly, but not unexpectedly, many people thanked him for saving them from a dictatorship. Do you have something to say on this? Please share with me. So let me think a bit further. For those who agree with Dorsey's move, mostly because they don't like Trump. Regardless of the likeness bit, we just focus on Twitter's censorship here. Is it the same as saying, in order to not to be interfered or affected by someone's speech I don't like, I'm willing to let you, Twittering, or Dorsey, to filter the good content for me, even though I sacrifice some of my freedom to exchange, right? But this way of sacrificing freedom in exchange for comfort, in fact, it is a very dangerous path, a path of no return to communism. Trevor Loudon, an expert on communism, once said that the most evil thing about communism is not about how much corruption it has created, how many people has been brainwashed, or even how many people it has killed. The most evil thing about communism is that it deprives individuals' responsibilities and at the same time deprives people's free will given by God. We can recall a series of leftist policies which basically belongs to the policy of sacrificing personal responsibility in exchange for comfort. For example, the universal health insurance for everyone, sacrificing the responsibility of choosing one's own health insurance and letting the government to provide guarantees to uniform health insurance, that is the so-called Obamacare, which was dumped by Trump. More than that, a lot more of the leftist policies are very communism-alike. We shall talk about that in the future. So don't forget to subscribe to our channel and turn on the notification bell. No matter whether you accept or not, the world is changing much faster than we expected. At this dark time, Twitter is just one of the bad apples in the name and shame list of the current big techs. We have to think about what we can do now in keeping our basic human dignity and our rights to free speech and free thought. Let me know if you have some ideas. Maybe moving to alternative social media platforms that supports free speech, like SafeChat, Gab, etc. Or simply switch away from the social media platforms totally if you like. Alright, that's all for today. Please give me a thumbs up if you liked the video and share with your friends. Thank you for your time. I'm Faye from Beyond the News with Faye.